Hi, everybody. I'm Tim Newton from the Krannert School, joined today by Dave Schrader, who also goes by, I understand, Dr. Dave.
That's right.
Dr. Dave is a graduate of Purdue, got his PhD here, and has worked in analytics for a long time. Specifically today, Dave, we want to talk about your work in sports analytics. Okay. How did you get hooked in that in the first place?
I retired.
So you had more time.
I had way too much time on my hands. The last company that I work for is Teradata. They have a Teradata University Network, which is an outreach program. It's free for students and faculty. So we give them the entire stack, the database, SAS, analytical tools. Mm-hmm. Tableau is very popular as visualization. So I had been doing big data talks back when big data was the big deal. And then I evolved into needing to have one new area that I could work on. So I decided I will roll up my sleeves and learn everything I can do on sports analytics. So that happened 4.5 years ago. I continue to give some of the big data talks, but I'm finding that students are mostly interested in sports analytics. So I do a lot of talks. Like last year, I did 59 talks at 32 campuses to more than 2,200 kids. So people that I know say that's a hobby. It sounds like work, but actually it's a good deal of fun.
You know, it seemed like sports analytics took off when Moneyball came out, both the book and the movie. And I think most people were confused. It really wasn't a sports book. It was a book about market inefficiencies.
Right. It was about the Oakland A's coming up with some new criteria that they had found to draft people, which, because nobody else was looking at these kids, they could get them much more cheaply. So they could do roster construction based on things like getting on base instead of RBIs. And in fact, one guy at the University of Alabama that they called up to say, we're going to draft you as number one, hung up the phone because he was not being recruited by anybody else and he thought it was a crank call.
So if everybody's trying to chase the same thing now, where is that whole finding the inefficiency? What's the new avenue that people are trying to get to?
Well, it really depends on what level you are. So if you're at the pro level, typically those people are starting to hire analytics people. At the college level, not so much. It really depends on the program, as you might imagine. I've heard University of Alabama has 8 analysts in our conference. University of Nebraska hired a full-time director of data analytics for their sports program. At the college level, things are starting to evolve. The problem is most of the athletic programs are underwater financially, so they don't have big resources, which was why I came up with this Moneyball on campus idea that we'll talk about in a second. At the high school level, I live in Southern California, so I have to believe that the Catholic League teams like Mater Dei or the entire state of Texas will start hiring all of a sudden analytics people to help with their athletics programs. So it's evolving.
Before we get to the Moneyball at the university level, I want to talk about the professional level. And I will tell you, I have a friend who works for an unnamed baseball team, Major League Baseball team, and he said there are two different camps there. There's the jocks, the former players, the scouts in one room. And he said there are we can call them the nerds, the geeks, whatever, the number crunchers who never watch a game, never leave the office. They sit in there, basically they sit all day and crunch numbers. From a management standpoint, how do you meld those two together?
It is no different from the world of analytics in the business world. So in many cases, there have been debates around, do you hire, say, Purdue stats people and put them in the basement and feed them problems and they go off and work the magic and come back with the resolution? Or do you, like at Bayern Munich, to pick soccer, do you co-locate the analytics people with the coaches so they can be in the meetings? They don't have to talk a lot. They have to pay attention to what are the coaches worried about. And then from that, they can formulate the problem. The key skill, what you talked about is the polar opposites, the geeks and the jocks is what I call it. But what you really want to do is treat the analytics people like translators. So they need to absorb problems. They need to go do the magical math and then come back, but retranslate the math into the problem. So if I come back and say, oh, we ran a genetic algorithm or we did a regression model, for the coaches, it's going to have no impact. If I can tell you on roster construction who you should have in the game at certain points, given who the opponents have in the game, or where their weaknesses are and what plays you should be running in different critical situations, that's the vocabulary that they want to hear.
Let's talk about this from a fan's perspective. We've really talked about it from a management standpoint of how you try to blend those two things together. When I was growing up, you had batting average, home runs, RBIs in baseball. Now we have BABIP and ERA plus and this and that.
Launch angles.
The launch angles, exit velo. What's the balance there? If you're trying to draw in new people who may not have been interested before, who can see the game in a different way, but you don't want to offend those people who just want to watch a baseball game.
Well, again, I think there have been a couple commercial attempts to try to interject more analytics into the fan experience. You could do that on television. You could do that on the handhelds. My personal mission is to analyze how much attendance has dropped at pro sports because of excessive TV advertising. So when people are sitting there in the stands, you need to give them something else to do. Today, a lot of the people switch over and do their fantasy football picks or check on other games. But I think you could use the analytics to enhance the experience for people that wanted it by giving them some additional information at their fingertips or letting them vote on what the next play could be, things like that.
Now, one of the things in sports analytics, it's not just the performance on the field that you can measure, but also the performance in the front office, in the stands, how you're doing fan interaction, how the fan experiences, how much money you can draw from the fans.
Right, right. In the talk that I'll be giving here twice, one for the stats group and one for the Krannert School business people, I identify five different areas where analytics can help. So you're correct, it begins with the front office. So things like how should we price individual game tickets or what are season ticket renewal probabilities? That's one area. Donors to sports program is yet another area. The second area would be roster construction. This is between the front office, especially for the pros where finances are very important, and the coaches and the scouts. And so being able to use more analytics like Moneyball, the original story, to do a better job of roster construction or making decisions about who you're going to cut is the second area. Third area would be team tactics. This is the one that I find the most interesting. So as we go from automating video and doing automated game cutups, if I pick football, coaches and grad students spend an incredible amount of time play by play annotating it with everything that was happening and then scoring the players and the opposition. If we can automate that with video analytics, so much the better. The good news for scene analysis, sometimes it's called, is that the problem isn't as hard as usual because the teams have jerseys on, so you can pick out all the people with the same colors. They often have a big number on them, so even though they turn away, if you can pick out that information, now you can do down to the individual player analysis, geography problems on spacing, making and breaking space is the big area. To continue, the fourth area is the area of health and safety. So things like recovery times, sleep studies, nutrition studies, and getting a holistic, what we would call 360-degree view of the athlete compared to a 360-degree view of a customer, which is well-known in marketing. You know, if you didn't play well on Saturday, was it because you didn't sleep well on Friday night? Can we see in Twitter you broke up with your girlfriend on Thursday? The coaches let you lift too heavy and their app-connected weight machines, and we can see things like that. Or to stick with the recruiting problem, humans are like machines. We know what the useful lifetimes are for individual sports and position by sport, so we can analyze that. And then the fifth area that I fell into 1 year ago was league analytics. So things like March Madness, things like seedings, things like tournament design for regional tournaments and how you assign schools to regions is an interesting area. And we did a project on that that I handed off this morning to the NCAA.
Good timing. Yep. So let's talk about the money ball on the university level. What's your concept there?
Well, what I've ended up doing, instead of just doing the overview talk like I did last year here at Purdue and a lot of other places, I've been invited to come in for a whole day and then meet with a variety of groups. So Moneyball on campus, it's almost a formula. It's an 8 o'clock meeting because coaches and trainers are early morning people. where I kind of scare them a little bit by highlighting what the pros are doing or what the most advanced college teams are doing for analytics. And and the reason for scaring them is to get them to open up to the idea of giving their data to their own students and faculty to do analysis on their own campus. If you're at the pros, you can probably afford to hire these analysts, but like I said, a lot of the colleges are not able to do that. But they have all this talent right on campus. Right. They have people in math, computer science, stats that would die to do projects with them. So the idea is soften up the athletic department to find some coaches who might have some problems and then may or may not have data collected on it, and get them interested. And then I meet with the faculty. And the interesting thing with the faculty is they have to write research papers, right? Mm-hmm. Many of them have never thought about the analogies between what they normally work on, like maybe transportation congestion problems mm-hmm. in an operations research group. Well, those things moving around are really not much different from players moving around. Or mm-hmm. if you do failure analytics or hazard models on locomotives and GE jet engines, I'm used to those case studies from where I work. Well, we can apply those hazard functions to athletes because they have breakdowns. They have. So if you have a subject matter expertise, it's not hard to put in sports as an application domain, but apply a lot of the areas. And then the least of my problems when I do Moneyball talks is the students. So mm-hmm. I've had an auditorium for 400 overflow at one school because word got out that Dr. Dave was back and I was popular the previous year. So when you put that all together, what I really want to do is get capstone projects going at each school mm-hmm. so that you can treat the athletic department like a data lab where you now get extra value for the students because they get to do interesting projects, but you also give back to the athletic department potentially some interesting insights on their upcoming opponent. So why not do it at this campus, right?
Out of curiosity, what's your favorite sport to watch?
Football, college football.
I agree with you.
Yep.
Well, welcome back to campus.
It's a good problem for analytics because the continuous flow sports,
yes,
you have to carve them up, right? So right. Soccer has a lot of activity, but not a lot of the interactions between the players are going to have anything to do with scoring, and it's such a low scoring game. Basketball is at the other end. So the key point here is what's the value of analytics? Right. And if you have a high scoring sport like basketball, well, then you might have, you know, 100 shots to analyze in the course of a game where the number of shots on goal for soccer is very low and luck is 50% and skill is 50%, where analytics can't help with the luck side. But if you have a sport like basketball where it's more like 75 or 80% skill, 25% luck, then we stand a chance of giving people an incremental advantage.
Always great to have you back on campus. Thanks
right.
for the time
today. So it's wonderful to be back at Purdue. Boiler up.
For Dr. Dave Schrader, I'm Tim Newton.
Thank you.